We are here today with Rachel Grant. She is the founder of Rachel Grant Coaching, and she's a sexual abuse recovery coach. She's also the author of Beyond Surviving, The Final Stage in Recovery from Sexual Abuse. She brings to the table a passionate belief that her clients do not have to remain trapped or confronted daily by the thoughts or behaviors that result from abuse. Through her own journey of recovery from sexual abuse, she has gained insight and understanding about what it takes to overcome abuse, and this makes it possible for her to relate to and appreciate the struggles of her clients intimately. And she holds an MA in counseling psychology. She provides a compassionate and challenging approach for her clients while using coaching as opposed to therapeutic models. Her website is rachelgrantcoaching.com, and she's also offering a consultation to viewers and potential clients. So we'll talk about that in more detail as we go along. Welcome to the show, Rachel.
Oh, thanks, Marie. So great to be here today.
Yay. So we're just going to take a moment to get centered. I really need this today. It's been a rough week.
Let's do it.
So we'll just take a moment. If you're in a place where it's safe to do so, you can close your eyes. If not, please keep them open. And we'll just take a nice deep breath deep into our bellies. And on the exhale, just letting go of any stress or tension. Just letting it out. And opening our hearts a little bit, just a little bit more than they were a moment ago, in the hopes that we can find some new insight today that will help us in our journey to living our best lives. And so it is. Thank you.
Yeah, great. Thank you.
And I just want to put a little disclaimer out there because we are talking about sexual abuse. So listener and viewer discretion is advised because this could potentially be triggering for some people, or if you're driving in the car with little ones, may need to change the channel. That's totally fine and understandable. So, Rachel, maybe you can tell us a little bit about what led you to becoming a sexual abuse recovery coach.
Yeah. Thanks, Marie. Well, it's great to be here with you all. And thank you for this opportunity to share my story and to talk about this subject of sexual abuse. It's really wonderful. Anytime we get the opportunity to break the silence and bring this into, the public eye is so great. And I certainly wound up here unexpectedly. It was not a well-intentioned plan a set schedule of mine to be here doing this work. But, my story really begins when I was 5 years old. My grandfather came to live with my family, and I was living with my mom and dad. My older brother and sister had already moved out of the house. And my grandfather, in coming to live with us, I was excited. I was like, woohoo, I've got like somebody to play with now, and like a companion and a friend and a buddy. And I certainly loved taking care of him. It really fed that nurturing side of my spirit to, take him a bowl of cereal or sit out with him on the front porch. And my earliest memory of abuse, though, is when I was 10 years old. So it's likely that the abuse started earlier than that, but as is very common for survivors of abuse, there's bits and pieces, but nothing fully clear until the age of 10. And we were sitting out on the porch one day and he began touching me. And for me, Marie, in that moment, of course, I just froze. I didn't know what to do. I didn't know what was happening. I was scared and terrified. And when I kind of finally broke out of that freeze state, I jumped up and I ran to my parents' bedroom and was crying and upset. And I remember thinking, like, what was that? And what just happened? And did I make that happen? And all of those confusing thoughts to just immediately rush in at the point of abuse starting. And it's that was really the beginning of, you know, the loss of safety in my home, and him going from being a companion and somebody who I enjoyed spending time with to being an abuser. And it went on for some time, and it got worse. Eventually, my mom discovered what was happening. She just happened to be walking by one day and saw what he was doing. And she kind of snatched me away real quick and got him out of the house right away. And I'm very thankful for that, Marie, because certainly now, 10 years later, since I started my business, I certainly have heard more than my fair share of stories of survivors who didn't have that kind of support and care from their family. And that's just so, it's re-traumatizing, of course, to go through that. So if we jump ahead from that moment to today, we'll cover a lot of years there, but eventually, you know, in my journey, I started to notice that this had really impacted my life and I needed to get some support around it. And so I did therapy, I read books, I did group programs, but there was always like something missing for me. I seemed to be getting a deeper understanding of what was happening and why I had the experiences that I had or struggled with the things that I struggled with. But, you know, Marie, there was that constant needling question in the back of my head of like, well, when is this going to be done? Like, am I ever going to be done with this? Do I have to just keep talking about it for the rest of my life? And it seemed that the answer to that question was yes, from the therapist and things that I was doing. And I felt really not okay with that. I was like, no way, that's not the right answer. And that's what really prompted me to go on my journey of getting my master's in counseling psychology. But probably the thing that really started to pivot for me the most was studying neuroscience and beginning to really understand how the brain is impacted by trauma. Because once I started putting those pieces together, I realized, oh, like there is a way out of this. There are actual things that I can do to transform these behaviors and break free of this. And so I just kind of started using myself as a guinea pig and trying this out. Okay, I can't, you know, I struggle in this area. What do I need to shift or do? What skill or tool do I need to become really equipped or confident in that area of my life? And eventually that's what all came together into today, what is the Beyond Surviving program and the work that I get to do with other survivors. So I'm in some ways as surprised as they are that I'm here doing this work, because I was just trying to get myself together, you know, but I am so grateful for it, because over and over again, I hear the same story from survivors. You know, I've been working at this for a long time. I've been trying to heal, but it seems like nothing's really changing fully or completely. And so it's a great honor to get to do the work that I do and really fill in those blanks for people.
Thanks, Rachel. So I'm curious, what's the difference between the coaching that you do and therapy?
Mm-hmm. So when I started really digging into this world of recovery, what I developed is my kind of philosophy of healing, which is that there are three stages to healing. And that first stage is the victim stage, when we're just still in denial. We don't want to deal with it. We don't want to acknowledge what happened. And we just kind of want to pretend that it's all like over there, not a big deal. And then there's that survivor stage, where we start to name and acknowledge the experience that we had. We begin to understand the connections between like our current behavior and past experiences. And that's where therapy comes in really wonderfully, right? It creates a safe space where we can just sit and talk and be heard and be reflected and seen and, you know, explore whatever it is we need to explore. And then there's that third stage, the Beyond Surviving stage, as I name it, which is really about understanding the skills and tools that you need in order to move forward in your life, so that the past isn't constantly, you know, interfering with your present. And that's where the coaching really comes in, and approaching things more from that perspective of like solution and collaboration, less so reflection and kind of internal, you know, kind of talk. And all of those are important to do. But certainly for the people who come and end up, you know, working with me, they've reached that place where therapy is no longer getting the job done. You know, they're past that place of wanting to just kind of be talking about or seeing and hearing it. And certainly there are therapists who are able to, you know, delve more into the, like, what's next and steps and things like that. But by and large, that's the key distinction between therapy and coaching. Mm-hmm.
So would you say that most of your clients have already been through therapy? Should Yeah. people go to therapy first before coaching? What do you recommend?
It kind of depends on your level of stability, how much support you have in your life. I've worked with people who, like, I'm the first person they've ever even told that they were abused. And so I'll only work with those clients if they have a really strong support system and structures in place, and by and large, there's stability. But most of the time, the people who come to me are those people who've already been through some therapy and have done some work around it, and now just need to learn some specific keys and tools to really kind of bring the whole picture together. Mm-hmm.
So I am really interested in neuroscience as well. I'm not sure if you want to talk about the neuroscience, what happens to our brain through trauma, or maybe we can talk about some of the skills. What do you think is more important to discuss first?
Well, we might be able to blend it together, which is my favorite thing about coaching. That is one part teaching and educating, and then it's one part, now here's what you can use, or here's a skill or a tool that's going to help you with that. So, you know, what I learned in my course of studying the brain and how it's impacted by trauma is that our neurological pathways are constantly being created and reinforced by experience. So whenever something happens to us, the brain on a neurological level is wanting to make connections and associations. So it's like this big highway, if you will, of these interconnecting roads. And whenever, like, that first experience of me running back to my parents' bedroom and being there upset and crying and nobody coming to check on me, well, in that moment, an association was created between being hurt and in need and having to do it on my own, right? There's nobody here for me. I'm all by myself. So this pathway in my brain got created just like that, as quick and simple as that. The problem is that then for the rest of my teens and into my 20s, that same neuronal pathway was there to be accessed anytime I had another experience of pain or hurt. That my brain just goes, oh, this is similar. And so it produces that same response or feeling or belief. Does that make sense so far?
Absolutely.
Okay. Now, because I'm doing that, though, because I keep going back to that same neuronal pathway, I'm reinforcing it. I'm making it stronger and stronger. It's like this one-lane road going to a two-lane, to a three-lane, to, you know, I've got this big, huge highway in my head of I'm all on my own. And so that's why for survivors, we find ourselves like falling into patterns or falling into responses or reactions so quickly and easily. It's because of those neuronal pathways that are created. Yeah. So I thought, well, all right, so if I've got these belief systems and these neuronal pathways that are causing me to respond over and over again, I've got to find a way off of these roads. Like, I've got to build some exit ramps, right? So that when something happens, instead of responding in that same old way, I can access something new and different. Yeah. So one of the exit ramp strategies that I teach my clients is to take a moment to really check in about how they're responding to this present day circumstance that seems very similar, that seems just like that old experience, but there's actually something different. And to be able to then challenge that belief in that moment weakens the neuronal pathway. So I'll give you an example of that. One of my clients had, when she was abused, there was this association or belief that got created that she was the bad one. She was the wrong one, right? I've done something bad. I caused this or created this, yeah? So in her adult life, when there would be breakdowns in relationships or something would happen, she'd immediately go to that. Oh, it's my fault. Of course, I must have done something. What did I do wrong? I must have done something wrong. And as a result of that, she'd feel anxious or upset, or really reactive, sometimes angry about it. So when we started to challenge that belief system, and by simply pausing whenever those moments would happen and looking to see what else might be going on, sure enough, she started to be able to respond in those situations with less self-blame. So, for example, her friend all of a sudden stopped calling her. And her first story in response, going to that neuronal pathway was, well, what did I do wrong? But then she used the tool that I taught her to pause and step back and go, well, okay, maybe she's sick. Maybe she lost her phone. Maybe she got abducted by aliens. We don't know, right? But there's all sorts of other possible explanations for why this person didn't call me. So rather than sit here and reinforce this negative belief and go into this negative space, I'm just going to hold off and wait until I get some explanation. And that's where the next step really came in of getting into communication, right? So she reached out to her friend and said, hey, I haven't heard from you a bit. What's going on? And it turned out exactly that. Her friend had lost her phone and was like, oh, I finally got a new phone and can talk again, right? So is all that pretty clear, Marie?
It is. It's just reminding me of, I'm actually in a situation right now, kind of similar to that. But the person, oh, it's, there's so much. I've decided not to be friends with this person anymore. So it's kind of triggering that. And there is always that, like, what did I do? So this person has apparently been telling all of these lies to goodness knows
Oh no.
what's true and what's not. And I've tried to clear the air, so I've reached out numerous times, and he hasn't contacted me back. And I'm kind of thinking it's because he's not willing to admit that he has been dishonest. And even still, I feel responsible for the people that he's lied to, that he's met through me.
Got it.
Somehow that's my responsibility.
Well, that's the next piece of it. And part of the reason why getting out of story and interpretation is so important, because we love to make stuff about ourselves, right? We always want to be the center of the cause and the reason why things have happened. But when we start to notice, wait a second here, there's somebody else in this equation who's making choices and taking action and doing things, then we get to shift that focus, from ourselves to really see, that there's other people involved here who are responsible for their choices and their actions. And, that really starts to carry. So now this is where, skills start to blend together, because that is foundational to being able to let go of shame. Shame really results from us taking responsibility for things that we are not at cause for. And being able to distinguish what's really in our bucket, right, from what's in another person's bucket is so huge. And God, that can be so hard for survivors of abuse, because it does seem like all of this is so interconnected. And if only I hadn't this, and what if I had that? So helping my clients make that distinction and separate where they begin and other people end. Is one of my favorite things to really work on, because once they have that clarity, oh, Marie, so many things open up, right? They're like, oh, you mean I don't have to carry around that crap anymore? Okay. So even just that sense of freedom and release is important. The other thing that starts to happen is, when our brain is constantly being triggered into old belief systems, that takes a lot of energy. It's draining, it's exhausting when we're constantly trying to evaluate and analyze everything that's around us, and of course bringing it back to ourselves in a negative way. That's really hard to deal with. And so The release of stress and anxiety, and people become more motivated and energized and, you know, ready to go out and do things that they really want to be doing rather than spending all day ruminating on, you know, this thing that happened. Yeah.
So Rachel, how long does it take? Because I mean, this issue, not specifically, but that being responsible for everything that happens in my little corner of the universe is something that I've been working on for many years. And even with the knowledge of neuroscience and neurobiology, it hasn't been easy. So how long does it normally take using your techniques to change these patterns?
Well, I think that there are neurological pathways that are weaker, you know, not as entrenched, or not haven't been as reinforced. So those can be fairly easily pruned, is the, you know, neuroscience word. It's almost like gardening. You go in and snip it, you know. And then there are going to be those belief systems that are a little bit more deeply entrenched and have more of a stronghold, if you will. So that's going to take some more time and repetition. But the way that I explain it to my clients is it's like, you know, let's imagine that I woke up today and I said, Marie, I am committed. I am ready to have 6-pack abs, right? But you know what? I got up this morning and I did 5 sit-ups and I ran over to the mirror and daggone it, no abs. This is stupid. This doesn't work. I'm not doing sit-ups ever again. Right? You kind of be like, well, Rachel, it's probably going to take more than 5 sit-ups, you know? And it's the same thing with our brain. It's that time and repetition. So when we think about it from the perspective of exercise, that if we can integrate some of these strategies, so, you know, the clients who I work with who kind of create it as a daily practice, boy, we see stuff just kind of dropping off left and right. And for some of my clients, they need a slower pace. They need more time to just kind of work and be with the skills and integrate. But even with that, they start to see it dropping away. And, you know, my one-on-one program is 8 months. And I've had people in my program who've been in, you know, 30 years of counseling say, holy cow, like I had no idea I could make these many changes and, you know, shift so many beliefs and drop, you know, so many of these patterns just in the course of 8 months. But once we have those tools in our toolkit and are accessing them, you know, pretty regularly, gosh, you know, really amazing things can happen. And so I wish I had a, you know, a one size fits all answer for that. But it is kind of dependent on your trauma and how much, you know, repetition there is. I'll say just one follow on thing from that comes to mind. One of the things that has shifted for me in my life is the frequency with which these old neuronal pathways get kind of lit up or triggered. So that's the first outcome that we're looking for. Some triggers can be completely eliminated, just gone. It doesn't even become a thing anymore. Other ones, because they're more deeply entrenched, you know, there's still a chance that they will be lit up. So part of our work is making sure that the frequency of that goes so way down, right? And then the other part of that is being really skillful so that if something does come up, you have an immediate response to it, right? Like I used to get triggered into something and I could spend months like in it, right? Just really soaking it in, just being there and, you know, almost cuddled up with my, you know, my false belief. But now if it does come up, I, you know, kind of immediately go to my toolkit and I can resolve that in a matter of sometimes hours, sometimes days, depending on what it is. So that's really the hope and the vision that I try to bring forward for survivors, that this isn't like, oh, you're never ever going to have a bad day, or you're never ever going to have an experience that brings up something that's, you know, hard or related to the past, but that you feel so equipped to respond to that it doesn't derail your life. It doesn't take away, you know, months or years.
Thanks. And your website is rachelgrantcoaching.com?
Yes, that's it.
And you're offering this 60-minute consultation. Mm-hmm. So if someone fills out the form for that and does a call with you, what's that hour going to look like?
So this is really an opportunity for me to get to know you a little bit better and to understand where you are in your healing journey. So we start off by talking about the biggest challenges that are there for you in the present day. Stuff that is just not working and there because of the abuse, but really focusing in on the present and what's happening for you. From there, we really create a vision of how you'd like things to be instead, right? Where are we heading? What do we want, you know, life to be like? And I also take folks through a little bit of an exercise so that, first of all, we can identify what might be keeping them stuck or blocked from moving forward in their lives, but also so they can begin to experience that coaching, right? And really kind of have that experiential moment to see if it's a good fit, if it resonates with them. And from there, that really helps me kind of determine what our next step should be. So anything from, you know, the free resources and groups that I offer to my foundations program, to the group program, to working one-on-one. So I've really tried to create, you know, opportunities to meet people, you know, at these different levels and where they're at. And after this consultation can kind of best recommend, you know, a path forward for them.
Thank you. So we are speaking with Rachel Grant, and she is a sexual abuse survival coach. And what she does is help people get beyond that level of survival and hopefully to the point of thriving in the world, which is what we're all about here at Synchronicity Radio. And you can find Rachel at rachelgrantcoaching.com. So can we talk a little bit more about what happens to our brain when the trauma happens? Because I've heard that people who have had trauma or people who are chronically stressed or depressed, part of our brains shrink.
Well, there's all sorts of different things, yeah, that can happen as a result of trauma. So let's see, how much time do we have, Marie? I think that maybe what would be of most value to folks listening, because this question comes up a lot, is why can't I remember the trauma? Why are there only bits and pieces? As I was talking about in my story, you know, there's a sense that things happened between the five and 10 year age range, but I don't have really strong, what I call in color memories. I have shadow memories, sensations. And why does that happen? So one of the things that occurs in the brain when trauma is happening is the amygdala, the part of our brain that's in charge of that fight, flight, freeze, gets, you know, set into motion. And the amygdala, when it comes onto the scene, it really likes to be, it's kind of like the bully of the brain, actually, because it likes to be in charge and like take over everything, which is really important to help us survive and to help us live, right, through a trauma. And the trouble with that, though, is the various parts of the brain that go offline impact emotional regulation, impact memory, impact speech, and impact rational thought. So just to focus in on one area of the brain that kind of goes offline when trauma is happening is the hippocampus. And this part of the brain is like the library of the mind. So it's where it's where we bring in the information of the experience, and it puts everything in order. And likes to put things in sequence, and then it sends it up to that long-term memory so that we can access it years later. So when we're being traumatized, the hippocampus is kind of taking a nap. It's on snooze. So you can imagine that the experience is not coming in a way that can be consolidated, put in chronological order, that there are pieces that are going to be missed. And then when it goes up to that long-term memory, there are going to be gaps. There are going to be blanks. Does that make sense?
Yes. I'm curious to know more about the shadow memories for people who might be watching or listening for a friend. Maybe they are not survivors of abuse themselves, and so it might be difficult to understand what that means. Can you say more about that?
Yeah, so a shadow memory is just my way of saying, gaps in memory. Or there's a sense of the memory, but you can't place the when and where, right? And so you might have a sensation of, like, sometimes people will have a sensation, a physical sensation, even a somatic sensation, like I have a closing around the throat. But I don't have the exact moment or memory that is attached to the reason why I'm having this kind of somatic response.
And that could happen. I mean, if we were a baby or a toddler and even just witnessed something unpleasant or scary.
Yeah.
We could have those kinds of problems too.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think the reason why I usually focus in on this particular piece is because a lot of survivors have this feeling or this idea, okay, the way that I'm going to heal, the way that I'm going to get over this is if I can remember every single thing, if I can put it in, you know, an exact order, right? And then I'll know that it's really true. I'll know that it really happened. And then I'll know what I need to look at in order to heal. But one of the best things that I've discovered in this journey in my own healing and in working with survivors 10 plus years now is that we don't have to remember those things. What we have to do is look at the symptoms or the outcomes and address those. And even if we never know why that particular symptom or outcome is there, we can still heal it by using the tools or skills that I teach, right? Which is such a relief, particularly for the clients who I've worked with who have, pre-verbal abuse or have, you know, repressed memory or just have very scattered, you know, recollections of what has happened.
So we don't have to have a memory of, oh, this happened at this time, and that's why now when someone looks at me this way or says this to me, I feel all panicked.
That's right. Yeah.
We just can deal with what's happening right now and how to skillfully handle it in the moment.
Yeah. Yeah.
And okay, so you have your session with a client and then they're out in the world the rest of the week or the month or between sessions. Mm-hmm. So how are they remembering to use these skills? How are they catching themselves?
Okay. Well, so one of the things that that is also a part of working as a coach is that there is a very structured curriculum. So prior to every session that I have with a client, they get to read some lessons from the Beyond Surviving guidebook, which I wrote and published, right? And is really our roadmap for our work together. So at the end of every session, they have a specific tool and skill that they're focusing on. So I think part of the other benefit of approaching recovery in this way is it helps us get out of what I call spaghetti brain of trauma, which is I've got this problem and what about that problem? And oh yeah, Rachel, we've got to deal with this too, right? I'm like, yes, yes. And we're going to get there. But here's step one. And now here's step two. So because we're doing it in this very bite-sized way, it helps them integrate these skills because they're really only focusing on like one or two things between sessions. And then they become comfortable with that. And then we add in the next step and then we add in the next layer. And then beyond that, you know, I have little flashcards for them and little reminders and different things that they can use to like make sure. And then I think the other thing that helps is just the Beyond Surviving community. So over the years, you know, the graduates of the program, as well as current clients, you know, get to meet and hang out in a Facebook group. And, you know, in that way, there's that reminder of, oh, yeah, I could use that skill here or that checking in process. And being able to be a part of that community helps people stay, I think, on track and focused on what they're practicing.
Mm. Oh, I think that's really useful because I find that, yeah, I definitely have spaghetti brain of not only the things that I need to work on, but just the to-do list.
Yeah.
It's like, Yeah. So it doesn't necessarily, I just want to clarify that if the client has had all of these upheavals in the week or whatever, they're not coming and sharing all of that. They're back to, okay, we're working on this skill this week.
Yeah, it's a little bit of a dance, you know, sometimes, because, like, for instance, I had a client the other day whose, you know, son was just really stepping over her boundaries. But she's a little bit earlier in the program where we haven't really gotten to setting boundaries and clear requests and various things. So in those moments, it's like, okay, we're going to get into this more deeply, I promise, you know, in the coming weeks. And for now, here's like a little Band-Aid fix. You know, here's something that you can do. So it's kind of, you know, balancing that act of, we're going to get there, I promise. And let's make sure that you have something that helps you right now in this moment as something is coming up for you. But the reason, sometimes people ask me, well, Rachel, why are you so strict about this whole like curriculum thing and like going in a specific order? But part of what I experienced in my healing was I'd go into therapy or I'd go into groups and I'd bring into that space the thing that was the most painful for me in that moment. You know, maybe I was feeling like I was having a hard time trusting my partner, or I was feeling really isolated and disconnected from other people. And my therapist would meet me where I was at, which is great in some ways, but if I'm not actually ready, if I don't have the foundational tools in order to actually work with something like trust, I ended up feeling like more of a failure, because she might say, oh, we'll go out and try this, but I don't have the confidence, or I don't have the self-esteem, or I don't have the communication skills. So now I'm going to try this thing, but it's going to fall flat. And because I'm a survivor of abuse, the next thing that happens is I shame and blame myself, right? So then that just perpetuates that cycle. So when I was developing this program, beyond just being really clear about, okay, if this is the issue, what do we do about it? I also paid really close attention to what I call the order of operations. You know, what does need to come first, second, last? I'll give you an example of that. The very last lesson in the program is how to have a conversation with the person who's abused you, if that's something that you want to do, and how to prepare for that. And over and over and over again, I heard from people who had tried to talk to the person who had abused them, most often going at it from the place of confrontation, right? Which is something else I teach, the difference between confrontation and conversation. But they didn't have resiliency. They hadn't actually let go of the blame for them, of themselves. So when the abuser would come back and say, no, no, this happened because, most of the time they'd fall back into believing that, right? So that's why it's the last lesson in the program, because it's like, let's make sure we have all of this so settled for you that if you choose to step into that, you're really prepared for it.
So Rachel, can we talk a little bit about what some of those foundational things are?
Yeah, sure. Well, I always start with the brain, right? That for me is always step number one, is regulating your system, learning how to work with triggers and de-trigger very quickly and easily. So what I call pause button strategies, so that anytime that stuff is coming up, you know how to respond. And we're going to decrease the frequency of that. Because when you're on too much of that emotional roller coaster and are kind of thrown back into that triggered state too easily, it's actually very hard to do any other healing work. And then from there, we take a very close look at that shame piece. How do we get out of self-blame, believing that the abuse was our fault? Because at the end of the day, when we have those beliefs, the next thing that happens is we're constantly dismissing our own needs, our own desires, taking care of everybody else, but not ourselves. So that's kind of the next piece. From there, we look at communication and setting boundaries and asking for support, so that we start to build community around us, so that as we start to go into things that are a little bit harder to address or process, you're not doing it alone, but you have that, you know, supportive foundation. And my goodness, the kind of the next piece is emotional wellness. So anger, fear, anxiety. From there, we look at relationship skills like trust, vulnerability, intimacy. And then, yeah, it just kind of all leads into the letting go piece and then the conversation piece. So that's kind of the broad big picture, if you will, of the road or the trip that we take together.
But is the conversation, I mean, you mentioned that the conversation with the abuser is only if someone wants to do that, because many people, either the abuser has passed on, sometimes in the family, it's completely denied.
That's right.
That's very common.
Yeah.
Or the person, for myself, I was in foster care. So there were many abusers and they could be all over the place. Like, yeah. There's really no way to confront that actual person.
Yeah. So when we do get to that stage, first of all along the way in the Beyond Surviving program, everything is a choice, because that's one of the very first things that's taken away as a result of abuse. So that's a very, very necessary part of the journey, that all of my clients have choice all along the way. And so when we get to this piece around how do you have a conversation with somebody who has harmed you, we take into account the fact that, yeah, some people are not going to have access to the person who abused them. The person might not be alive, as was the case with me. My grandfather died about a year after the abuse stopped. And or you just don't have access to them, or it's not safe, like you said, or not possible. So one of the things that I do with my clients is a simulated conversation. So creating the space and opportunity for them to say whatever it is they would like to say if that person were right in front of them. And I hold space for that and usually end up reflecting back for them a few things that that help them feel complete about that.
Oh, that's really interesting, because I feel like a lot of when someone has wronged us, whatever extent that is, whether that's abuse, whether that's, you know, firing from a job, mm-hmm. or lying to us, whatever the wrongdoing is, so many times that person will never acknowledge.
Right.
We only have control over our own behavior. And I know that for a lot of people who are abuse survivors or in codependent relationships, survivors of narcissistic abuse, one of their biggest challenges is that frustration with the person never taking ownership of the wrongdoing.
That's so true, Marie. And the saddest part of that for me is when people end up in the conclusion that until this person acknowledges what happened, I can't heal and move on. That's terrible, right? What a stuck place. And so that's exactly why, you know, I approach this piece of the journey in the way that I do. I definitely talk with people about the common responses that you get from if you do end up having a conversation. Usually it's, you know, a rationalization or denial. Very seldom is it remorse or acknowledgement. And so if we're going to go into having a conversation where the chances are that we're going to be dismissed, the person's going to deny or rationalize what happened, we've got to be prepared for that. And so, you know, I take my clients through a game plan strategy that helps them really tune into that. And so, and also really know that you get to be complete and whole and move on with your life, even if this person never, ever acknowledges what they did to you.
Well, I'm glad we covered that, because I know that is, even knowing that that could happen and even practicing acceptance that that's how many people are, it's still so hard.
It is. Yeah. I think that when we do that simulated conversation, which by the way, I do with clients who do have access to their abusers, right? But just for the experience, and I reflect back to them, I basically stand in place of the abuser and, you know, speak on behalf of the abuser. And I really ask my clients to listen, not from the place of, do you think they would actually say this, but just from the place of receiving it. Over and over again, there's huge healing in that moment, because there's a very cool thing about the truth. No matter who says it, it's the truth. And it can be so healing to just be acknowledged, even if it's not from the person who maybe needs to do the acknowledging. So yeah, that's one of, I think that I love so much of the work that I get to do with my clients, but that can be such a very a tender and very special moment that I really cherish when we get to experience that together.
Okay. And again, I want to put that disclaimer out that listener and viewer discretion is advised, because this is a sensitive topic and of sexual abuse and recovering from sexual abuse. And one of the things that I've struggled with as far as even identify, it's that unwillingness to want to identify as a sexual abuse survivor. Mm-hmm. Because of maybe the extent of the abuse or the memory about the abuse, like it wasn't bad enough to qualify as abuse because I've heard these other things that have happened to other people. Or in one case of abuse, I was underage, but it was consensual,
mm-hmm.
but I was a child. Mm-hmm. So a lot of people, I think, have that feeling of, well, if I consented on any level,
mm-hmm.
Even if it was because they were too afraid to say no,
right.
Then that doesn't count as abuse because they didn't say no. Yeah. So what kind of spectrum of people would benefit? At what point on that abuse spectrum should people be seeking help?
Mm. Anytime your life is not the way that you want it because of an experience that you've had that you're not complete about, let's get you some help. That's kind of my short answer. And, you know, what you were describing there, that's one of the reasons why in the very first session of the program, we talk about minimization and dismissing and comparison, that doggone comparison trap. Boy, what I've been through is not as bad as others, or, you know, maybe I played a part in this and, you know, this, that, and here are the circumstances for why it's my fault or why it happened and all of that. Because just coming out of that space and really recognizing that no matter what your experience, it matters. And there's this great quote by Viktor Frankl that I share with my clients about how Viktor Frankl, you know, survived the Holocaust and wrote an amazing book, A Man's Search for Meaning. I highly recommend it to folks. And he talks about in that book how suffering is like a gas. No matter what the size of the chamber, the gas will fill the entire space. So abuse is not quantifiable. It's not measurable in that way. If I was touched once, or if I was touched 1,000 times, it still fills up the space. It still can impact my life. And if it's impacting your life, it deserves to be looked at, period. And to be resolved, and you to be free from the impact of that experience.
And again, we don't have to go through every detail of it and relive it, and because that's right. Just like...
No. Well, that's the other side. Yeah, I get some clients sometimes who are like, Rachel, like, it's going to take me the rest of my life to unravel all this trauma because it's been this, and then it's been this, and what about this experience, and I've also had that happen. But going back to a neurological level, what I've started to notice is that by and large, people have, let's say, you know, this isn't scientifically proven, so take it with a grain of salt, but in the ballpark of 5 like core false beliefs, right? So like mine were like, I'm not valuable. People are always going to leave me. I'm an object to be used by other people. I'm unlovable, right? And how funny, I'm forgetting the 5th one. So that's good. It's probably just all gone. Mm-hmm. And so what starts to happen is we have an abuse experience. Core belief is created. We have another abuse experience. Maybe that same core belief is reinforced. And then maybe a new one is also created. But when we start to look at the tapestry of trauma, it's not the individual experiences that are the problem. In fact, It's not even the abuse experience that is the problem. It's what we make that abuse experience mean, or what we come to believe as a result of the abuse experience. That's what trips us up in our lives, because, and we know that because the abuse isn't still happening. If the abuse was the problem, then we'd have to have abuse, you know, all along the way, that same abuse happening every single time. But it's not. What's the problem is the belief system. So all we have to heal are the belief systems. And regardless of whether that belief system is there because of one experience or 100 experiences, soon as we resolve the belief system, you're good. You're ready to go. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I really, thank you for clarifying that. And I think that that's going to give a lot of people hope because.
Good.
So, we've been speaking with Rachel Grant. You can find her at rachelgrantcoaching.com. The name of the book is Beyond Surviving, The Final Stage in Recovering from Sexual Abuse. Again, rachelgrantcoaching.com if you want to set up a consultation with her and see if coaching is right for you. This is not therapy. It's not the same thing. But Rachel, is there anything that you want to add or reinforce before we wrap up?
I'll share one other free resource for folks just while I'm thinking of it. The stages of recovery that I was talking about earlier, victim, survivor, beyond surviving. Sometimes people are like, well, how do I know where I am in that, you know, spectrum? So I have a guide, a little checklist that people can download, and that will help them define where they are, which stage of healing they're in, and will also tell them like what kind of goals you want to focus on based on which stage you're in and what kind of support to get that's going to most help you in achieving those goals. So they can get that at rachelgrantcoaching.com/checklist. And I'd love for people to pick that up. That's a really wonderful place to start as well. So I want to make sure people know about that. And then beyond that, I just want to, again, thank you for the opportunity to be here and to share myself and my journey with folks. And for those of you out there who have experienced abuse, I really do hope that, if nothing else from our conversation today, that you have connected to the possibility of a future where all of this crap from the past, you know, is not there and constantly interfering. There really is a path forward out of that pain, and you do not have to, you know, continue going through life feeling broken or burdened or impacted by these experiences. And of course, if there's any way that I can be of a support to you in navigating that journey, I absolutely welcome it.
Great. Thank you so much, Rachel. Again, we've been speaking with Rachel Grant. You can find her at rachelgrantcoaching.com. If you're watching this on YouTube, I will post links to what we've spoken about in the description below. But if you're listening on the radio, rachelgrantcoaching.com is her website. Thank you so much, Rachel, for your time today.
Yeah. And I also, I don't know, since I'm just getting to know you, if you've talked about your experience, so I just want to acknowledge you in this moment as well. Thank you for, you know, talking about your own journey and healing and experiences, and just for being vulnerable in that way and authentic in that way. It's so cool. And I appreciate that, Marie.
Thanks so much, Rachel. And thank you for listening or for watching, for being with us today. I want to send you lots of love and acknowledge you for the time that you've spent with us. Be well.
Take care, everyone.
Thanks so much. I'm just kidding.